Week two of Modern Family. And it's not just about communicating as husband and wife. That's a part of it because we're talking about families, but we're communicating as people. Did you know that? Several years ago when Jonathan and Kagan were very small, at the Walmart on Southmore, if you go out and down, it was brand new. It had just been built. It was maybe 2 or 3 weeks old. And Jonathan and Kagan would go with me in the store or to the store early on Saturday mornings. That was our shopping time. So Pam would make us a list, and we would go do the grocery shopping. And Kagan was in the cart one particular day, and we have taught the boys very plainly to be colorblind. It doesn't matter if you're orange. They're not going to notice because we've taught them that way. We want them to be colorblind because that's what heaven's going to be like. All kinds of cultures, all kinds, well, one culture, there's a God culture, but all kinds of races and ethnicities, and that's what heaven's going to be like. So we just taught them to be colorblind. So Kagan's in the cart, and we're shopping, doing our thing, and I walk away for just a little while to the frozen bags of chicken and come back and see this kind of exasperated, strange look on Kagan's face. And he says, "Dad, you see that little brown boy over there?" There was a little Hispanic boy in one of the shopping carts. He said, "I went over to him and I tried my Spanish," because the boys were always, they would sing a song. We did some bilingual things back in the day, and we're getting ready to do some more. But we did some stuff back then, and they would sing a song in English. They'd sing it in Spanish because they knew the lyrics. And then Kagan would say, "And now in French." And they would just sing the same thing, but they thought it was in French. Or "now in Chinese." And they would just do it. Well, that was what he was doing in the shopping cart. He said, rattled off some stuff that he was manufacturing as his Spanish. And he said the little boy spoke back in his Spanish, and we just spoke English. Because Kagan didn't understand Spanish, didn't know how to speak Spanish, so he couldn't speak the language. It's very important that we understand the language we're speaking. We're not talking about English tonight. We're talking about communication. Oh, yeah. An example would be this. Pietà, Signore, di me dolente. Signor pietà, se a te giunge il mio pregar, non mi punisca il tuo rigor, me no sei veri, cremenciognora, voci tuoi sguardi, so proud. Do anyone understand what I'm saying? You got to, it's Italian. I tried to choose something that no one was good, but it's Italian, but it's saying, "Lord, have mercy on us because of what we have done." That's what the lyrics are saying, but you got to know the language. So tonight we're talking about speaking the language of communication.
So we all speak the same language, but do you ever feel guilty for telling the truth or speaking how you feel? A couple questions for you that maybe you've asked. Now, this is not just for married folks. This is for children, parents, aunts, uncles. If you are breathing and you are human, it's for you. How can I express my feelings and my needs without feeling selfish? A marriage, 9, 10 years going along, things have changed, and the wife says, "You know, I've got this guy that's been flirting with me, and I really don't want to have an affair with my husband, and my husband won't be affectionate with me. How do I tell him? Because if I say something to him, he's going to think I'm just badgering him or that I'm thinking he's not good enough. But the truth is, I have needs for his affection, and I want it from him. How do I say it to him without children, young people who still want to spend time with their parents? How can they say, 'Mom and Dad, I just need some time with you,' without feeling selfish? How about the mother who has bought everybody else new underwear except herself?" The reason we're laughing is because it's true. The mom sacrifices. Okay, sorry. You can take that out of the video if you like. But anyway, we get the point. Mom sacrifices and sacrifices and sacrifices for everyone else because she's loving and she's giving. And then she feels guilty for saying, "I really need some new shoes. What about this one? I always seem to say the wrong thing to hurt people's feelings. What can I do to prevent this? And then when I do hurt their feelings, how do I even start fixing it?" How about this? How can we communicate without putting each other on the offense? How many of us live that way most of the time? But I was just, oh, hey. Someone's talking and our immediate response is, not my fault. That's not what I meant. Da, 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 da. Okay, we're going to. And then this one really great question. Why do we argue so much? Why do we argue so much? I know the boys, they wrote this song because, you know, they have experience. and they're very close. They're very, very good friends. But you know what? They have conflict. We are very close. We met having conflict. You know, you get two strong people in the same room and you're going to have different ideas and you're going to have conflict. Conflict is unavoidable. You're going to probably hear that a few times tonight. But that doesn't mean that you can't have a great relationship. So the boys in the car, I never allowed them to yell at each other. I never allowed them to scream at each other. I never allowed them any of that. I would say, they heard the snap. Someone said to me, don't snap at your kids. They're not dogs. I said, what do you want me to do, yell at them? I can get their attention just like that. I used to do in a church in Ohio. I'd snap my finger and all the young people would go. It's really cute. So I'd snap and say, uh-uh-uh. You can say what you need to say in a way that your brother can hear you. How many of us as adults need to hear that? Okay.
Sometimes when we're communicating, our level of real communication may actually not be quite as high as we think. We may be filling it up with words, but not really seeking to understand or speaking to be understood. I have a friend, he's a minister friend, and he gets very animated when he speaks. And he sounds just like a cartoon character. And so he feels like he's just really communicating because they go, I just told you so. This is so exciting to me. It's so exciting, so exciting, so exciting. The Spirit is leading us tonight in this church service, and it's just wonderful. You really can't fit anything in because, for one thing, you can't get past what he's saying. I'm making myself not laugh. But that's the honest truth. That was exactly how he speaks. And it's hard when we're not really able to communicate well. So we have to, first of all, learn to speak to be understood and then also listen to understand. So look at someone and say, I'm going to speak to be understood. And then say, I'm going to listen to understand. Sometimes sometimes they will argue or disagree about things, especially. Okay, now let's back up. When a couple is newly engaged, everything is love. It's so wonderful. They're warm and fuzzy, and the heart's pumping and thumping, and they're so excited. Every little touch, you buy a Snickers candy bar for him, and he's happy for a week. Just all these little things are so new and so real and so rich and so fantastic that everything is wonderful. Well, a lot of times when we're engaged, we put our best foot forward. And so we will go the extra mile to make sure that we are meeting her needs, or that we're communicating, and we're speaking our heart, and the big, tough, burly guy is going to be transparent, and he's going to let his lighter side show just a little bit sometimes, and she's going to be happy about that, and she's going to communicate, and it's just this big ball of wonderfulness. But what happens is because we're so caught up in that romance, in that early stage of romance, we sometimes are shocked when inevitably a conflict comes up. Now, again, we're not talking just to married people tonight. We're talking about everybody. And the conflict skills, resolution skills, the communication skills that we're going to give you, the tools that we're going to just toss out to you tonight, there's something that everybody can use in every application in life. So really, it's not a question of if, but when conflict or when miscommunication comes, how are we going to handle it? So first of all, we're going to listen to understand.
All right. In order for us to do anything, we have to apply principles from the Word of God. Right? Because His Word is life, life to our relationships, life to our mind, life to our emotions. And so we're going to take a principle, we're going to take a truth, and we're going to apply it to our lives. At one time, we were in a marriage class, and I had a lady, we were talking about one of these principles in marriage, and she goes, oh, honey, not in my culture, we don't. And I said, I got really scared for a moment because I was like really young. And I'm like, how do I reel this one back in? And you know what the Lord gave me? He said, my word is above culture. My word transcends culture. So it doesn't matter what the culture, doesn't matter the ethnicity. It is the word of God that we're going to be judged by, right? So we need to know it, and we need to apply our lives to it, not make it fit us, okay? So the Bible has much to say about the act of communication because God knew it would not be a skill that comes easy for us. But in doing so, that we would grow, isn't it hard to communicate right? It's like biting your tongue, piercing your tongue, biting your tongue. We grow in our dependence on Him, and we grow in relationship with each other. Those moments where you just hold things back. Have you ever told a child, don't say everything you think? Children, young people, have you ever been told, don't say everything you think? Have you heard adults say everything they think? Don't answer that. So let's just listen to this principle right here. But let everyone be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. Now, many of us are quick to speak, aren't we? We're not quick to hear. We're quick to speak because we're afraid that if I don't say it, I'm not going to get my way, I'm not going to be heard, and it's this louder, 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 louder thing. And yes, there is a need. We all have that need to be heard, okay? And we need to take the time to do that for one another. But the Bible says, I want you to say it with me, but let everyone be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. So what are we quick to do? We're quick to get angry, and we're quick to speak. And no, I'm not listening to you until you hear what I have to say. I'm going to tell you. Right? Let's go to another verse. This is too much fun. A wise man will hear and increase in learning. Did you know that when you listen to people, you actually learn things about them? So, this is for everybody. If you are wise, you will hear and you will learn more and become more wise. In your dealings with people, you will learn how to facilitate conversations, how to meet their needs. Okay? And a man of understanding will acquire wise counsel. You know what that simply means? If you have understanding, you're a bright person, you're going to ask questions. Have you ever tried to explain something to someone and, I mean, you're deeply pouring out your soul to them and they just kind of go, yeah, well, the other day I was just, and they move on to something else. Wouldn't it have been nice if they had asked questions about what you said? Because then that shows that they're actually listening. So let everyone be quick to hear. That's good. Slow to speak and slow to react. If you are wise, you will hear, you will listen, and increase in learning. If you have understanding, you will ask good questions.
There are probably some ways you can figure out right now that this would work in your relationships, whether it's at home or at work, aren't there? Thank you for that rousing response. That was wonderful. But listening is so hard. It's difficult work, isn't it? Am I the only one in the room that thinks listening is hard? Oh, thank you, section. Right, you're my favorite right here. But it's hard. We have to hear with more than our ears. We use our eyes. Did you know that we use our eyes to listen and we use our hearts as well? So it's a big job. That's why authentic communication requires proper listening habits. Here's some proper listening habits. First of all, we focus on what's being said rather than how we feel about what's being said. Because we may not like it. But we focus on what's being said rather than how we feel about it. We focus on the way it's being said. For example, the tone of voice, the posture, the way that they are standing.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. Say, I'm sorry. Pam will usually follow that up with, well, you don't look like it. Or you don't sound like you're sorry. Stop it! But focus on the way it's being said, for the tone of voice, the voice, the posture, rather than just the words that are coming out of the mouth.
Because it is possible for someone to say something It is possible for them to say words that are hard to hear but have tears pouring down their face.
That's true.
So their body language is telling you more than those words. So you have to look at that too. You can let me go.
Focus on clarification of valid points, okay? Rather than defense of incorrect accusations. That's hard. Focus on clarification of valid points rather than the defense of incorrect accusations. For example, you always do this. Well, not always, because there may have been a time in 1998 that you didn't. And maybe you want to defend that one time. So it's very important that we focus on the clarification of valid points. Okay, what did you mean by always? Focus on asking questions rather than the indictments. Okay, there may be focus on understanding rather than making a judgment or passing judgment on what's being said. There are also some listening questions.
My husband is one of the best peacemakers I've ever met. And thank the Lord he was, because I wasn't. And we'll talk about that a little bit later. I'm just being transparent. So, you know, I've learned the Lord has changed me. Okay, the Word of God has changed me. And so I'd rather show you my scars and those things that weren't so great and show you how God has helped me than to pretend like I've always been perfect when I'm not perfect now. That would be unrealistic. So here we go. So listening questions. This is one of the things he did really, really well. So when someone's been talking to you for a period of time and they're just going on and on about something, and they're talking and they're expressing their concern or their hurt or their disappointment or their frustration, it's a good thing to ask this question. Are you telling me that, for instance, are you telling me that when I'm late, that makes you feel like I'm being disrespectful to you? And then they can say, yes, because I planned out blah, 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 blah. And then you can talk about saying, okay, how can I do this better? Or you can apologize. I did not mean to make you feel disrespected. Or they can say, no, it's just that I was late to this, and da, da, you know, they can clarify, and it gives them an opportunity to be more clear about what they're saying. Are you telling me that blah, 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 blah? Basically, what you're doing is you're reflecting back what you think you heard them say. That's very important, because what you think, have you ever had someone walk away from what you said and tell someone you said something you didn't say? Wouldn't it have been nice for them to say, is this what you're saying? And then you can say yes or no, 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 no. That's not what I meant. This is what I was saying. Okay. Another one is, what did you mean when you said, I feel like I'm in this all alone, for example? What does that mean to you? You feel like you're in this all alone. Is it because someone is, you know, no one's helping you, or that someone forgot about something they promised to you, or did I forget about, you feel like you're in this all alone? Financially, what does that mean to you, and how can I help you? Is there something I can do? So that goes to the next question, the summary questions. Of all that you have said, what do you want me most to understand? Now, women, we are spaghetti, and everything touches, and everything counts, and everything matters. I'm probably more of a boxy spaghetti than anyone, because I'm very analytical, so I'm really good with boxes of spaghetti. But still, I'm still a woman, and so things still kind of accumulate for me, okay? An example of this, when we were in Stockton, in the morning, we got up, we're getting ready, and he just said something that just kind of crossed me the wrong way. And it probably wasn't intended to at all. He was probably just fussing about something that he didn't like, or you know how you are in the morning, you just say things. And so he wasn't directing it at me. It was just, I just heard it, and it just kind of, meh. You ever felt that way? That first comment of the day just kind of sets the tone for the day. So I had a, meh, in the morning. I go to school, I go to work, I have a conflict with this person, I have a frustration with this person, then I go to the office waiting for him to get ready to go home, and he said, I'll be 5 minutes, it ends up being 2 hours, and then I was doing something else while I was waiting for him for those 2 hours, and it's, hey, we gotta go, let's go, let's go, let's go, and I'm like, oh, I've been waiting on you for 2 hours, and now we're in a rush because now you're ready to go, and okay, and so we get home, I'm cooking supper, and I'm in the kitchen, and he comes in, and he says just something, and I just look at him, because the pot is hot and full. And he says, what's wrong? Now, what I knew is, really, he didn't do any of it intentionally, but it still all was touching and mattering and boiling up in me right now. And so I said, okay, well, this morning, this is what happened. And I recounted every event of the day. Not all of them included him, but some of them did. And Jonathan did this, and this is what I'm frustrated about this, and then we were waiting on you, and then we da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And he says, what do you need from me most right now? What a smart guy. I didn't care that I knew where he got the information from. He asked the right question. Jeopardy. He asked the right question. He didn't tell me what I needed. Now, this works for men and women. It works for teenagers, too. Sometimes we tell each other what we think we need instead of asking, what do you need most from me right now? And you know what? I stopped, and I looked at him. I said, I need 10 minutes. I need to go take a bathtub and just disconnect. I just need 10 minutes. And he said, okay, I'll finish dinner, and I'll clean up the kitchen. And literally, when I came out of the bathroom 10, 15, 20 minutes later, I was a different person because I was heard. He cared about what I needed. He gave me a break from that moment. Okay? So these are really, really great questions, clarifying questions. Are you telling me that, blah? What did you mean when you said you wanted to chop my head off? Okay? And then summary questions. Let's just wrap this thing up. And I want you to know that what you've said is important to me. And so the questions of this one is, of all that you have just said, what do you most want me to understand? And then give them a chance to think about it. Not everyone can come up with it that fast. And the last summary question is, what do you need from me most right now?
So that is listening to understand, but we also have to express ourselves to be understood. For example, a tea kettle just goes, and just lets off steam. That's the only thing it can do. It just screams. Sometimes we respond to conflict and situations like a tea kettle. We don't try to take a second and express ourselves to be understood or make it into little bite-sized pieces so that they can understand. They go, that's all we do. That was perfect, and that was exactly what I was hoping for. Thank you for your response. But true communication is revealed in the responses that we get. Did you hear that? What happens on the flip side of what we say is how well we are communicating. It's revealed right there. So we're talking about expressing ourselves to be understood. Look at this. Ephesians 4:29 says, let no unwholesome word proceed from your mouth, but only such a word as is good for edification. It goes on to say, according to the need of the moment, that it may give grace to those who hear. So our words should be nice to people, like Piglet would say. Our words should play nice. There are three types of communication questions. There are open-ended questions, and these questions basically cannot be answered by yes or no. Did you sweep the floor? No or yes, okay? An open-ended question is different. They encourage the other person to open up and provide information. So how did it go sweeping the floor? Well, I didn't sweep the floor, okay? They're still telling you no, but there's a little more response in there. Okay, well, how come you didn't sweep the floor? It kind of encourages conversation, encourages the person to open up. So open-ended conversation or open-ended questions are not a yes or no question. It helps the person open up a little bit. A directive, or let's talk about reflective questions first. These are very cool because this is when you allow the other person to kind of elaborate or expand on a statement after you repeat a particular word. So basically you're listening to what they're saying, and then you pick out a word out of what they're saying, and you respond to that, and you build conversation that way. The third type of question is directive questions. These questions will guide the other person toward a desired, specific place by putting a piece of information out there and allowing you to quickly move to the response that you want. Now, there are some things that we have to consider. First of all, we want to avoid using directive questions to manipulate the person. We don't want to just put information out there and bait them and trick them into something. That's not what we're trying to do. But in all of these things, in all of these types of these three different questions, the open-ended, the reflective, or the directive questions, we have to consider this one thing. First of all, Rudyard Kipling says there are six honest serving men. These words, six honest serving men. They are what, why, when, where, and how, and who. So what do you think about this? Why do you think this is best? When could we, where should we, who do you think, how do you feel about? Those are the words that we really need to put into our questions to help us get a little bit deeper. Then proactive listening. Contrary to what people think abroad, I know it doesn't happen here in this incredibly great church, but listening is not passive. It's not something we just sit there and go, have you ever spoken to somebody like that? I mean, they just go deadpan when it's not their turn to talk. Or it's the other person going, hurry! Because they've got something they've just got to put in. Maybe you've been around someone like that. But there's a leading Broadway stage director who once said, acting is reacting. It's done with the ears, not with the mouth. So that's a pretty powerful statement. How do you get someone's attention to allow for productive communication from you? Well, you do it. It's not by talking at them or by making clever remarks or things that impress others about you. We never get deep in conversation by telling people impressive things about me. I mean, you could tell them things about me if you want to, but that's not how you're going to get deep in conversation. The biggest mistake that we make in conversation and in talking and in communication is when I begin to talk about me. I begin to talk about myself. I want you to do this. I feel best about this. I think it's the me monster. Maybe you've heard Tim Hawkins, who goes, me. And it's the whole me thing. It's all about me. And there used to be a song, it's all about you. But sometimes we turn, it's all about me. Maybe you've heard that. By showing interest in the other person for 20 minutes, all right? You can make more friends by showing interest in another person in 20 minutes than you can in 20 weeks of showing how interesting you think you are to them.
Can you say that again?
I will gladly say that again. By showing interest in the other person for 20 minutes, you will make more friends in 20 minutes than you will in 20 weeks of showing someone how interesting you think you are. Last couple things I want to leave you with this, and then Pam's coming back. There's a communication countdown. Listen to this. The five most important words a parent or leader or communicator can say are these. I am proud of you. Some weighty words, aren't they? The four most important words in communication. What is your opinion? The three most important words are, if you please. The two most important words in communication are thank you. And the most important single word is you.
You know, what I feel in this place is that there are people who know that this is a difficult thing for them. And we don't want it to be, do we? We want to have intimacy, and that means into me see. I want to be seen, and I want to be known, and I want to know you. And I don't want all this noise and static to be between us. There are some really great scriptures, and Jonathan will recognize some of these because we memorized these when he was little. He was talking by the time he was two. And negotiating at two. So when a child can talk by two, you know, everybody says they're terrible twos. I really don't agree. I think it's just at two they learn to talk. And we can't control their mouth anymore. That's the only thing that's different. Because it's really was a lot of fun. So, but here's some real a great proverb for all of us. When there are many words, this is Proverbs 10:19, transgression is unavoidable. Have you ever been the one that you just kept talking and after a while you go, oh man, I should have shut up. I really should have closed my mouth. Or you're standing there and you're going, you just need to stop. You just need to stop. You might want to stop. Have you ever been with somebody in a store and they just keep, okay? When there are many words, transgression is unavoidable. It means the more you talk, the more likely something is going to happen that you don't want to happen. But he who retains his lips is wise. And here's the one that we loved. He that keepeth his mouth keepeth his life. How many guys have gotten punched because they just didn't shut their mouth? Oh. But he that openeth wide his lips shall have destruction. You know what? These are really great filters. The word of God is a filter. And let no unwholesome word proceed from your mouth. Is that a truth? Is that the word of God? So if I'm letting unwholesome word proceed from my mouth, transgression is going to be unavoidable, and I just may lose my life. See how those scriptures kind of work together?
We're going to quickly blitz through the last two things here. First of all, of the last two things, in the same way that we seek clarification while we're listening, we are listening to understand, we're speaking to be understood, we have to be deliberate, and we have to choose what we're going to say, how we're going to ask it, how we're going to present the questions as we're going to seek help or seek to resolve conflict. So the first thing we want to do is we're going to determine what we want to say. We're going to try to resolve the conflict. You know that Scripture commands us to be peacemakers. It's not an option for a believer to be a peacemaker. So we can't just speak our mind all the time and say, that's just the way I is, because God made me that way. It's not true. That's contrary to the Word of God. Scripture says take every thought captive. That means every single thing I say should be filtered by the filter of the Word and the Holy Ghost. So we want to determine what we're going to say. First of all, what are my assumptions, my beliefs, my desires, my dreams? What do I need? What am I trying to communicate? Then I'm going to determine how I want to say it. Am I going to be excited? Or am I going to be sad? Am I going to be concerned? Am I going to be encouraging? So we're going to determine what we want to say. Then we're going to determine how we want to say it. Then we're going to determine when we want to say it. For example, we may not want to talk about something super-duper serious at a baseball game. You know, when they're bringing the hot dogs by and you got the big $22 hamburger in your hand and juice dripping down your arm and the team scoring, and it's probably not a good time to say, I think we need some marriage counseling. Probably not a good time. But do we want to say it during or after a meal, during recreation, at bedtime? Do we want to say it in the presence of kids? Do we want to say it while we're driving? You know, it may not be a good time either. But think about how employing these tools, thinking about what I want to say, how I want to say it, and when I want to say it, writing it down on note cards, having notes. There's nothing wrong with having notes to talk with anyone. I do that all the time. If I have to talk about something that could be touchy or sensitive, I always make notes. I don't sit there and go, and you are a schmuck. There, I said it. I don't do that. I mean, I would have that part memorized. No, I'm kidding. Not really. But can't you see how these speaking tools can help you in resolving conflict?
You know, there was this concept years ago, and I was raised in a home that had this, and I understand the basis of the principle, but there was a problem with this principle. So I think there's a balancing of this principle. So I'm not, you know how sometimes they say don't throw the baby out with the bathwater? So this is, let's just kind of be balanced when we get this one. But here was the deal. There was an era that said, don't ever have conflict, but they use the word fight. Don't ever have conflict in front of your children. Okay? So instead, you could tell the tension was there and the silent treatment was applied and you never saw them resolve it. Or, my parents never fought. My parents never had disagreements. What's wrong with my marriage? Why do we have conflict? So I think that there's a balancing of letting your children see you have disagreements and resolving them biblically. Because then the children don't feel like they're a complete failure when they go into their own marriage and then they have conflicts. They don't know how to resolve conflict if you don't show them how to resolve conflict. So, I mean, obviously, don't talk about things that are so weighty and hard and heavy, you know, and if you're still working on some of your resolution skills, maybe don't practice, you know, practice ahead of time. And no, I'm just kidding. But so the scripture has a lot to say about the power of the tongue and of the listening ear. And if we want to develop an intimate relationship in our family and with those that we come in contact with, we would be wise to speak less and listen more. The person who speaks less is more willing to set his or her own selfishness aside and to build oneness in their relationships, unity. He or she is better able to understand another viewpoint and is willing to seek the best for others. That's pretty powerful, isn't it? So in resolving conflict, let's look at a verse that's Ephesians 4, verse 26. Be angry, yet do not sin. Do not let the sun go down in your anger. So, did you know that the emotion of anger is a red flag, a red light for you? It's a signal that something is wrong. And anger can motivate you to some really, really good things. Okay? Would parents ever correct their children if they did not ever get angry? No. Okay? You don't discipline them in anger, but sometimes anger is a motivating factor. Have you ever stood up for someone because it made you angry? Okay? Have you ever seen injustice? So anger is an emotion that God had, and it's an emotion that we are like him that we have. But it is a warning sign. It is to tell you something is wrong. So you have to ask yourself this very important question. I'm angry. Why am I angry? And now I'm going to go back to the root, and I'm going to deal with the root. Oftentimes when we are hurt, when we have been treated disrespectfully, when we've been overlooked, when we feel controlled or manipulated, we get angry. But really, is it the fact that we're angry? No, it's the fact that we feel something else. So we have to stop, take those emotions. Something's wrong, gotta change. Okay? So be angry, but don't sin. So when does anger become sin? We always think about when you explode, when you punch people, when you scream and yell. What about when you hide it in your heart and go, I'm going to withdraw from that. You're not going to be able to touch me there anymore. Fine. That's fine. Bitterness, unforgiveness, resentment. Be angry, yet do not sin. Do not let the sun go down in your anger. Meaning, don't let time keep slipping by without going and dealing with what you are angry about. First, you've got to deal with it with you, or else you're just the tea kettle. I'm going to just tell you how I really feel about this. Blah, 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 blah. Turn around and walk off. You just went, there was no resolution there. That was just you letting off some steam. Right? But to go and talk and say, I just need you to hear me for a minute. This is how this made me feel. And I want to resolve this. I want us to be back into relationship.
In any relationship, it's common for both individuals, we're almost finished, to respond to conflict in different ways. And there are some very common, we're going to give you four of the most common ways that people will respond to conflict in any relationship. It doesn't matter if it's at work, if it's between parent and child, or between husband and wife, or grandparent and grandchild, or employer, it doesn't matter. We'll respond usually in one of four ways. And the first one is?
I'll talk about this one because I was a trooper. I had medals all over the walls with this one. It's called Fight to Win. It's not good, but I had it. I had that one down. First of all, I was a redhead. I was the youngest child of five kids, and there were three brothers. And I learned very early on, if I wanted to be seen, heard, or get food, I had to fight. And I felt unprotected. I'll just be really honest with you. I felt unprotected because it was assumed that because they're my brothers, they would protect me. Well, they were stupid boys. And that didn't work out so well for me. So what happened in a natural way of trying to be heard, to be safe, became a way of life. And it was a fight to win. This is, I win, you lose. Even if you're 99.9% right, I'm still 0.01% right. And I will not say I'm sorry until, okay, because I'm right, you're wrong. I win, you lose. This type of personality seeks to dominate the other person, and personal relationships take second place to the need to triumph.
The second one is when we withdraw. This is when we seek to avoid discomfort at all costs. So we'll just say, you know what, I'm uncomfortable, so I'll just get out. I will just withdraw completely. So you see no hope of ever getting through the conflict, so we just, or maybe we lack the strength to confront it, so we just cope by giving the other person the silent treatment. Maybe you've seen that where the mom will just go to the sink and begin to wash dishes. And snot's coming down, tears are flowing down, and someone will come up and say, Mom, what's wrong?
Nothing.
And when mom or wife says nothing, it means everything.
The next one, the first three are wrong, by the way. The last one will be right, and he'll present that one. Yield. This is, rather than start another argument, whatever you wish is fine. Okay, whatever. You assume it's far better to go along with the other person's demands than risk a confrontation. And to you, a safe feeling is more important than a close relationship. But what looks like peace is peace faking, and you're doing nothing but stuffing it down. Stuffing, 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 stuffing.
The last one, which is the only way to correctly resolve conflict, is to lovingly resolve it. Now, that doesn't mean you're going to go up to your best buddy at work and go, I just love you and I want to resolve this. Probably not going to do it like that. But it does mean that you're going to commit to resolving that conflict by taking the steps that we need to take and saying the things that we need to say and acting the way that we need to act. Resolving it lovingly, taking the right steps to do it. Because with the three other styles, the fight to win, the withdrawing, the yielding, do you know we actually create as many or more problems than we ever do, than we could ever solve? We create even more problems than we could solve. So fighting to win, withdrawing, yielding, all these things will allow us to escape from the situation, from the conflict. The bottom line is, resolving conflict requires forgiveness. That's the most difficult pill to swallow, because we want them to pay. I had a friend recently that said, I just want them to pay for the damage. The way that I hurt inside, I want them to hurt just like that. The bottom line is, though, it's giving up the right. When we forgive, we're giving up the right to punish the one that has wronged us. Man, that hurts, doesn't it? When we have to give up that right, because until we give it up, it just sometimes feels good to hold that in. But you know what it is? It's like drinking Drano. It is just a little tiny bit every day. It's a little tiny bit, and the first thing you know, you've lost feeling in your tongue. And then you can't, your throat is not able to swallow anymore because you're drinking that Drano. You're drinking that poison of we would use the word to the opposite of forgiveness. We'd say unforgiveness, but that's bitterness. I understand that. But sometimes we can say unforgiveness, and it's a little more easily communicated. But when we don't forgive, we're drinking that Drano. So.